climate change skeptic Scott Pruitt, the head of the EPA, visits a coal mine in West Virginia. By Justin Merriman, Getty Images. Donald Trump's meeting with Pope Francis in May, the final stop on his whirlwind tour of Abrahamic religions, concluded on a fittingly apocalyptic note. Over the course of his first foreign trip, the president had wiggled to a traditional Ardisaur dance in Saudi Arabia before securing a $110 billion arms deal, declared that both Israeli and Palestinian leaders are surely ready for peace, and, on a pedestal in Riyadh, accused Tehran of stoking the fires of sectarian conflict and terror in the Middle East. Arriving at the Apostolic Palace accompanied by his wife and daughter, both veiled so solemnly that they looked like enthusiastic extras on the set of a soprano's funeral, he was taken to the pontiff's private study. Some 30 minutes later, he left equipped with a small sculpted olive tree symbolizing peace, and copies of two of the Pope's works. The first was his 2017 peace message, titled Nonviolence, A Style of Politics of Peace. The second was Laudato Si, Francis' encyclical letter on the need to protect the environment from the effects of climate change. "Well, I'll be reading them," said Trump, improbably. The Pope's warning apparently had little impact on Trump, who announced 1 week later that he would be withdrawing the United States from the Paris Climate Accord, a landmark commitment to reduce global carbon emissions in the hopes of avoiding planetary catastrophe. Of course, the atmosphere hasn't stopped warming, or the seas rising, just because the White House has chosen to ignore the overwhelming evidence that human activity is the primary culprit. According to a government report that was leaked to the New York Times, average temperature in the U.S. have risen rapidly since 1980, and recent decades have been the hottest in the past 1,500 years. Evidence for a change in climate abounds, from the top of the atmosphere to the depths of the oceans, reads the congressionally mandated report, which was drafted by scientists spanning 13 federal agencies. The National Academy of Sciences has signed off on the paper, and it is now awaiting approval from the Trump administration. According to the Times, scientists fear that the Trump administration could either alter or suppress the findings, and for good reason. The notion of the president's team signing off on such a report seems about as plausible as the president having read the Pope's manifesto. Its assertion that many lines of evidence demonstrate that human activities, especially emissions of greenhouse heat-trapping gases, are primarily responsible for recent observed climate change jar inconveniently with Trump's instinctive assumption that global warming is actually a hoax perpetuated by the Chinese. It must be irritating for the White House, then, that just as the Times broke their story, The Guardian obtained a series of emails that implicate his administration in a bout of hoax perpetuation, too. Staff at the Department of Agriculture USDA have been told to get inventive with their use of language, and are being advised to replace the term climate change with the phrase resilience to weather extremes, according to the outlet. Bianca Mobisclun, director of soil health at the Natural Resources Conservation Service NRCS, a USDA unit that oversees farmers' land conservation, helpfully circulated a concise encyclopedia of other, non-synonymous terms. For example, reduce greenhouse gas could, and should, be replaced by build soil organic matter, increase nutrient use efficiency. Sequester carbon is no longer wholly appropriate, so staff should now refer to build soil organic matter. We won't change the modeling, just how we talk about it. There are a lot of benefits to putting carbon back in the soil. Sick, climate mitigation is just one of them, she wrote in an email to staff on February 16, referencing advice from a colleague from the USDA's public affairs team to tamp down on discretionary messaging right now. Still, her note was not all negative. References to economic growth, emerging business opportunities in the rural U.S. and improved aesthetics should be tolerated if not appreciated by all. In another email to senior employees on January 24, just days after Trump was inaugurated, Jimmy Brambellot, deputy chief for programs at the NRCS, said, "It has become clear one of the previous administration's priority is not consistent with that of the incoming administration. Namely, that priority is climate change. Please visit with your staff and make them aware of this shift of perspective within the executive branch." He added that prudence should be used when referring to greenhouse gases, and that existing work on air quality regarding these gases could be stopped. That the administration's efforts to reverse Obama-era climate policy have led to censoring science should come as no surprise. This past week, the State Department began the formal process to withdraw from the Paris Climate Accord, officially notifying the United Nations. Trump has instructed the Environmental Protection Agency to scrap or change regulations aimed at reducing greenhouse gases, and has started to open up more public land and waters to fossil fuel activity. Mentions of the perils of climate change have been removed from the White House's website and the Department of Interior and, in April, the EPA eliminated its online climate change section pending a review that will be focused on updating language to reflect the approach of the new leadership. It is also precisely this approach that is attacked in Laudato Si. The Pope's interpretation of climate change is unique in that it twines natural degradation with moral and social degradation. We cannot presume to heal our relationship with nature and the environment without healing all fundamental human relationships, he writes. Trump's drive to twist science to frame his political objectives is linked to his wider worldview, which is frenzied, inconsistent, and relentlessly aggressive towards those who veer outside his thin roster of American archetypes. In turn, Trump has become a problematic, pontifical archetype, himself, the lurid embodiment of a new type of contrived emotion which has more to do with devices and displays than with other people and with nature. As the Trump's administration dominates the headlines, perhaps the greatest and longest-lasting hoax of his tenure in the White House will not be his obscure entanglements with Vladimir Putin, but his attempts to control the way that we talk about the very soil under our feet. As the world warms, the president's war on science, and on the planet, may prove more central to his legacy than to any political intrigues with Russia.